Hello everybody, and welcome to Getting Started with Sakai. This is a non-live version of an Introduction to Sakai workshop that the Center for Pedagogical Innovation at Brock University is offering to members of Brock teaching staff throughout August and September. If you're interested in joining a live version of these workshops, do feel free to investigate the details within this video's description or reach out to the Center for Pedagogical Innovation at edtech@brocky.ca. So today's plan is to discuss Sakai, Brock's learning management system, and that includes what it is and how to find it, and as well provide some concrete steps for some tasks that might be handy as you undertake your courses in the coming academic year. So that can include, of course, creating a new Sakai site for your teaching or simply just for your testing purposes. How to share things within your new Sakai site, like the course outline, the syllabus, assignment descriptions, readings, and so forth. How to connect with your class, either through email, through announcements, or other types of methods. How to add grades and feedback for your students. How to collect submissions from your students, and that, of course, can, in the current context, include digital submissions from your students. And the initial steps to beginning to work on online modules. The full creation of online modules is a little bit out of scope for today's workshop. Some information will certainly be available within the video's description about how you can more deeply investigate how to make use of online modules, or more specifically, the lessons tool within Sakai. So Sakai is Brock's learning management system. Before the pandemic occurred, it was used by roughly 80% of Brock courses, although it's certainly not a required product at Brock University in the current context in which courses are to be delivered largely online. It may be helpful to consider Sakai as a complement to your teaching at the very least. Interestingly, Sakai is an open source platform and learning management system that's developed by academic institutions throughout the world. If you do find it handy to bookmark handy locations across the web, and that can include things for your teaching or for otherwise undertaking the tasks of your life, adding a bookmark to lms.brocky.ca to your internet browser can be quite handy. Likewise, if you prefer a more scenic route to Sakai, any Brock website, so that can include typing in brocky.ca within your internet browser or simply doing a Google search for Brock University, will bring you to a Brock webpage in which a menu icon that's being displayed on the right of the page now is available to you. Clicking upon that menu icon will produce a larger menu in which the Isaac Sakai link is provided that will bring you directly to lms.brocky.ca or Sakai. If you're just beginning your work for the day, or you haven't used any other Brock services in the last little while, you will be asked to log in with your full Brock email and the Brock password that you typically use. The most common usage for your Brock password, of course, is probably going to be logging into Wi-Fi or to Workday or other products which share a single sign-on with Sakai. Apart from the specific tasks that I've noted already, Sakai is generally quite useful from a teaching and learning perspective for, of course, quickly creating a common space that, from a computational perspective, you can ensure that all of your students will have access to, and is a handy location to connect students to other digital locations if that's handy, or knowing that if you do want to communicate with your students using an announcement or a particular document, that they will all have technical access to Sakai, so long as they have officially enrolled in the course that you're delivering that term. As I noted, it's also a handy location for sharing or collecting course content from your students, so that can certainly mean you distributing course information, readings, syllabi, etc., or collecting documents from your students using a number of methods, and as well facilitating interaction amongst your students. Now that can certainly be synchronous or asynchronous interaction. There are some very commonly used tools in Sakai in particular that are excellent at facilitating asynchronous interaction. And then finally, and what we'll explore partially today, the delivery of fully fledged course content in an online format, and that can include course modules or highly structured week-to-week online course content. The development of fully online modules is a little bit out of scope for today's workshop. However, we will explore the initial steps to it. And I'll note again that there are some links in this video's description to some more in-depth resources that will allow you to begin getting started with the lessons tool and developing online modules in Sakai. If you would like to receive some help, and that can include discussions around planning your online assignments, planning your course as a whole, constructively aligning it with the program level objectives, or simply determining what the correct toggles are for the tool that you've chosen to use within Sakai, you're more than welcome to contact edtech@brocky.ca. I would note that this email address does primarily seek to assist members of Brock teaching staff, so that can include, of course, members of faculty, TAs, sessional instructors, and so forth. So firstly, now that we've actually visited Sakai, and I previous to beginning this recording, I have logged into Sakai, and I did so using my full Brock email and password. I'll begin by creating a new Sakai site. So upon logging into Sakai, you should see roughly the same information, although dated if you're watching this a little bit into the future. Clicking upon the Sites button in the upper right of the screen, at least so far as the screen for me is structured currently, will open an additional menu that allows me to create a new site. So I'm presented with two options for site creation. The initial option is that of a more formal course site. And throughout the process of undertaking this option, I'll be asked not only to determine what the academic term will be for this site, but also which sections or courses of students that I wish to add to this new Sakai site as I'm creating it. It's important to note that making a new Sakai space and choosing which students will be in that space are actually two separate processes, although they are integrated in such a way that they do feel very much to be the same thing. I'm not actually instructing any courses in the forthcoming term, and I won't be presented with any useful options to demonstrate today. So instead, what I'll choose to do is create a project site. I do recommend that anyone using Sakai at Brock University actually do consider creating a project site, mainly because doing so will allow you to have a safe space in order to explore the creation of new content, to try out new tools, and to do so knowing that the individuals within that space are only those that you've manually chosen to add to that space, or of course can simply be a private space for you to technically test out new ideas. That's what I'm actually going to choose to do today by clicking upon the project site option, and then ultimately I'll choose a name for the site. Now there are a series of options for me to undertake today. In the interest of time, I'll actually skip these, although adding a description of the course and some contact information is both a popular and a useful step in the initial setup of your course site. In the process for creating a new site, I'm also being presented with the choice of the range of tools that exist within Sakai that I can choose to enable within my new site. Learning management systems and certainly online teaching spaces tend to have a less is more set of values, so it is worth considering what is needed both for the course itself and for your personal teaching style. For our purposes today, I will be enabling several tools that I very much intend to demonstrate. And as well, I'll note that we will have the opportunity to revisit these choices, both to enable new options or to disable the options I've chosen just now. once the Sakai site is made. And lastly, I'll choose not to publish the site just yet. When one creates a new course site, and I would note that this is a project site, but however, when a new course site is made, students are automatically given access to that space. However, if the site is left as a draft, those students will be present within that space. The master switch, or the power switch, if you will, is turned off, and only the instructor is able to see that space. It's quite handy if last-minute configurations or optimizations are still needed in preparation for delivering a course with that site. All right, so I have just created a new space, but I'm going to search it out. There it is. And so welcome to our new space, everyone. As a bit of a tour, I'll highlight that on the left side of our new site is the list of tools, some of which we chose to enable and others are there by default. In particular, I'm noting that the site info tool and the resources tool, which we'll explore in a bit, and the help tool, of course, are present by default within Sakai, but the announcements, assignments, and gradebook tool were all choices that we made during setup. Along the right side of the page, or the other sort of 80% of the page, is the context of the tool that I've just clicked upon. So if I choose to click upon the announcements tool, this page populates with information from the announcements tool, which is configured, however, is currently blank for reasons we might expect. So beginning our tour first with the site info tool, which is a sort of command central for an instructor of a course. It's where a great many configurations and choices about the way that a site will operate can be made. Today we'll actually look a little bit closely at what the steps are to enabling new tools, if it's necessary to add any additional people to a Sakai site. And I'll note that your students are added automatically, although if you do wish to add a teaching assistant to your site or another colleague with whom you intend to co-teach the course, that is a manual step. And as well, making the choice ultimately to publish or unpublish your site, should you choose that a site needs to be unavailable for a brief period. So starting again, after having clicked upon the site info tool, we'll choose Manage Tools, and we'll find that the range of tools once again are being presented to us. If I've decided in this time that in fact I do want to use the Forums tool, I can choose to click upon it. And if I've had second thoughts about the usefulness of the gradebook tool, I can actually deselect it. I do intend to discuss the gradebook tool today, so I won't be deselecting it. Okay, and then we'll confirm that the addition of the forums is indeed what we'd like. And now we see that the forums tool has been added to the space. So moving on to other useful features within site info, there are, of course, are quite a few. As I noted, your students are automatically added to your Sakai site should you choose during the setup process what the configure or which sections ought to be connected with this space. If you would otherwise like to manually add students, which is typically not a process that you'll need to undertake, but if you've got teaching assistants, for example, students that are choosing to audit your course, or if you've got colleagues that would like to either jointly teach a course with you or with whom you'd like to simply share content or teaching strategies, they will need to be automatically added to the space. So that process begins with the Add Participants option. And then the first part of a Brock email is what the software is looking for in this scenario. So in the case of myself or my alternate email address, I'm going to add that. And as well some test user accounts that we've created. So we've entered them within that space. Oops. And then within the next page, we are able to choose what role these individuals will possess once they've been added to the new Sakai site. An instructor user is the role that I currently possess within this site. So this would be providing these individuals with administrative level permissions within the space. I don't quite intend for that to be the case. So I'm in fact going to choose for them to have a student role within this space. So after doing so, I'll click Continue, choose whether I would like to send an automatic email to those individuals confirming their addition to the space. I'll choose today not to. However, this can often be a useful feature that is worth considering. And then finishing. So the site info tool automatically reloads with the Manage Participants tab open so that I'm now able to see the range of individuals that are within this space. In my case here, this is only a 4-person site. Typically, Sakai sites can involve a great many more students, and all of which would be displayed within this space here, and possibly across several pages, in fact. Oops. And then lastly, there are several opportunities to choose to publish a new Sakai site, including the Publish Now button presented atop the page, which I can choose to click right now. And after a moment, we'll see that the site has been published, which means that these individuals that have a student role within this space are now technically able to visit this Sakai site and see its contents. If in fact I've done that accidentally, or if I've had second thoughts about the readiness of this site, I can choose to select the Manage Access area, choose to leave the site instead as a draft, and click Update. So now we're back to possessing a yellow band atop this space. So though the site info tool does have some useful features, those are the three that we'll explore today. And now we'll move on to the announcements tool, which is a very handy methodology for sending important information to your students that can often be connected with their Brock emails if you're interested in not only contacting students through your Sakai space, but as well reaching them through their Brock emails as a secondary method of reaching them. So we'll click Add, and very much like the crafting of an email, provide a title of the announcement and a little bit of information that will represent the body of the announcement. I may return later to include information about how I wish to be contacted. That tends to be a handy first point of contact for students, as well, of course, as presenting that information within your course syllabus, as this will serve as a handy reminder for ways at which you'd like to be contacted, whether that be Brock email, through a video conferencing software, or some other method. I'll also choose to send an email notification of this announcement out to the Brock emails of the individuals that are members of this Sakai site. A brief note about that in particular during the first weeks of any course, students will be receiving a lot of email, not only from Sakai, but of course from other services at Brock University. So at least within those first few days of class, it's worth considering not effectively speaking too loudly to your students by digital means, so that when it is time for a contact of some kind to be made, that your students are likely to receive it. In this case, we'll mainly for testing purposes, we'll choose to send out this email notification, and then we'll click Post. So now we see that the announcement has been released. It's both available here within this Sakai site when a student clicks upon announcements. It's actually also available within the overview area by clicking upon the actual title of the announcement, and as well as been passed on to the Brock emails of our students. So moving on to the resources tool. The resources is a very traditional tool, at least in terms of learning management systems, as it desires very much to be a file repository for your course. Today we'll be demonstrating the process of uploading the course syllabus to the resources tool, which tends to be the one of the first critical bits of information that students are looking for within your course, and as well students have been shown to be highly likely to check resources first when they're looking for that information. So we do recommend that you add your syllabus at least to the resources tool, if not to another location. So to upload a syllabus document, we'll click upon the Actions button and then Upload Files. This allows me actually to upload my resource or my syllabus from my computer that I'd like my students to have access to, and then choose to either drag the document upon this space here or to more traditionally navigate upon my computer to click upon the button in the center. So the thumbnail has appeared and the document's actually waiting for us to take some action, so we'll click Continue. And now we see that our course outline or syllabus has been uploaded. It is available to students when they open the resources tool, and when they click upon it, this particular PDF document will open for them in whatever way they've chosen PDF documents to behave within their computer. If I'd prefer an additional point of contact within the toolbar for the course outline, which can of course be quite handy, I will choose to actually create a link to this document's residence here within the resources tool. So when a link is presented in the toolbar, it'll direct students to this document and again provide a second point of contact. So within the actions bar, or a button associated with this document, we'll click upon Make Web Content Link. And we'll title the link Course Outline. And now we'll see that a new link for the syllabus is actually being presented here. There are a great many different methodologies with the resources tool, in particular creating new folders. If perhaps I would like to keep all of the readings for the course organized. So now when I choose to actually click upon the folder itself and then the Upload Files option, I can choose to add a document directly to this new folder that I've created. So quite simply, that is the usage of the resources tool. We're going to move on now to the gradebook tool and for methods of not only assessing but leaving feedback for your students. There are a number of methods within Sakai to do this, of course, and that does include connecting the gradebook tool with other tools or means of submission that your students might undertake, like submitting an online test within the tests and quizzes tool, or submitting a digital assignment within the assignments tool, which we'll explore in just a bit. But for purposes today, we'll actually explore directly grading students within the gradebook tool here. So we'll begin by setting up our course weightings. And this is based on the information that was available within the course outline, which hopefully is aligned with what I'm about to type. So we'll click the Settings option, and then click upon Categories and Weighting, and then Categories and Weighting again. Now the reason that I am actually choosing to undertake the more fully fledged Categories and Weighting step is that within the components of the course, which I'm about to enter within this space, there will be a series of sub-components. So what that means within the weekly quizzes component of the course, there will actually be a series of quizzes that are all to be individually evaluated. And adding all of those quizzes to a category that the gradebook understands to be valued at 20% will help to more accurately calculate a final course grade. So we'll take a moment to add the remaining components, as this page actually is quite a stickler for ensuring that everything works out to 100%. And Now that all of the course components have been added, we'll click Save Changes. Okay, so we've added some categories or some meta information around our gradebook, but not much has changed just yet. What we're lacking now are the individual spaces through which we'll provide feedback to our students. So let's begin to create several, although not all of them. So despite the participation grade of the course being set to 20%, I am going to choose to evaluate participation out of 100 points. That's simply for clarity and ease of use, as there are a great many grading rubrics that do make use of values of either 10 or 100 or perhaps 5. And then we'll choose to include this within the participation category. Excellent. So now we've created a new column that we can see is titled Participation, and as well we're getting a little bit of information around what category that column is included within. So again, the section that I'm hovering over now is the item in the space in which we actually are able to enter scores for our students, and then to the right of it is the category that's informing its overall value within the course. So for our unfortunately named test user 1, I'll provide a score of 95%, and that's simply within the participation component of the course, and that has updated the value that student has received within the weighted average, or within the category, to also be 95%. And because we've now only got one value to evaluate a student within the course, that student is currently running at a 95% average within this space. Let's also choose to add a textual comment. That this student is able to see when she or he does choose to log in and click upon the gradebook tool. And as an instructor, we're notified that a comment is available within the speech bubble area. Okay, so let's also choose to add several others. Oops. So we'll add several weekly quizzes. And in this case, I've added a weekly quiz 1, which will ultimately arrive as its own column, and a weekly quiz 2, also valued at 10 points, that will become included within the weekly quizzes component. So we'll create those, and we'll now find that we've are now being presented with a new category that we created previously. So once again, with our unfortunately named test user 1, we'll provide a score of 8 within the weekly quiz, assuming that, of course, our quiz has been undertaken. In the space between creating the configuring our gradebook and discussing it, and we'll see that in adding the value of 8, we've also updated the category progress as a whole for that student and the course grade. A brief note about the course grade column. This is by default just being presented to members of the Sakai site that have an instructor role within the space. So that means by default students are not able to see this value unless you choose to release it to them manually. And of course that's indicated by the icon here that when hovered upon will confirm to you that grade has not been released to your students. So that is actually a rather complex exploration of the gradebook tool. We will, in the next tool, which is the assignments tool, actually explore linking the assignments tool into the gradebook so that we're able to see the results of grades that have been or feedback that's been provided in the assignments tool be sent automatically into the gradebook tool, allowing for a bit more of an organized grading process, in particular at the end of the term. It's quite handy to have taken these strategies early. So we'll switch over to the assignments tool now and find that, of course, it is empty, just as the other assignments were, or the other tools were, rather. And we'll create what will, at least from the student perspective, amount to a series of digital submission buckets, very much like the Dropboxes of old, in which students are able to submit their papers, often within the hallway of the department and so forth. So this is a digital version of that that allows for what can allow for quite a bit more flexibility in terms of when students are able to submit or choose to submit. That certainly needs to be aligned with your own teaching strategies and the needs of the course. Oops. So we'll create our first weekly learning reflection. It is useful to, if possible, provide information or instructions to your students within this space. At the very least, ensuring that students are connected with the course syllabus so that they're able to know what the steps are to this assignment is probably a useful and critical measure. So scrolling down this page, we do see that there are a great many options in terms of configuration. We'll not explore all of them, but in particular, it is worth noting the dates that are given to us as choices. The open date is the date at which students will begin to see the assignment, and it means that it is available for them to submit. So in this case, we'll choose to make the open date August 10 at the very beginning of the day. And that the due date ought to be several days later at what is the latest moment of the day that we're able to provide. And a brief note about clarifying dates or due dates for students. Students are automatically receiving or making use of calendar information within Sakai. It is useful to set the due date of an assignment at a time where they are unlikely to be confused about what they're being shown. So for example, setting an assignment due time at midnight often results in 12 o'clock being displayed for students. That to some can result in a little bit of confusion around when that 12 is occurring, whether it's at midnight or noon. And likewise, if students are making use of a calendar, when exactly that date is going to be presented to students, if you choose to actually make the due time at midnight, may lead to some confusion and some potentially lost marks on behalf of your students. So it's useful to consider instead using the 23:55 time, the latest point in the day that this interface provides for, as the late time and the due time. Oops. So we'll also choose to provide a little bit of leeway to students, which will have to occur within the next day. To provide for the occurrence of technical mishaps or certainly legitimate challenges that are occurring in life that might spare your student a little bit of anxiety and the need to reach out to you and as the course instructor for you to enter the assignments tool and to provide for an additional allowance for your student. So this does provide for about 35 extra minutes to your student to submit. This is not cosmetically presented to your student, but rather provides a little bit of technical leeway. If a student does submit between the due date and the accept until date, an annotation of late is provided to that next to the student's submission that both you as the instructor and that the student is able to see, as well as a timestamp. The submission type box, which allows for both textual submission and assignment attachments, much like an email attachment by default, is worth considering. If you do intend for your students to submit an attachment like a Word document or a PDF, I do suggest changing this selection to simply attachments. And I spoke briefly a little bit earlier about connecting the submissions here in the assignments tool by your students with results in the gradebook. So that means that when students have submitted and as the instructor you have provided feedback and grades, that information will be shared with the gradebook in the hopes of consolidating the course grading process or progress and allowing for a little bit less administrative time or lag with the end of course calculation. So we'll certainly choose to do that and as well choose to grade this out of 10 points and to add this information to the gradebook. So this is a weekly learning reflection, so we'll actually choose to add it to that category in the gradebook tool and post. So we've made an assignment, or as I described, a digital bucket into which students are able to make their submissions. Students naturally yet do not have access to the Sakai site. However, the grading process is still something that can certainly be demonstrated here with the help of our test accounts that we've added. So as the instructor, assuming that the deadline has now passed for the assignment, which of course it's not, and I can choose to click upon the grade option for that assignment, and were submissions to have occurred, see that submitted times or submitted stamps will be present here, and as well submitted statuses will be present within this column. To begin to grade students, I can click upon their name, and we'll find that the submissions of an individual student will be presented in this space here, where presently we see no submission. There will be actually a downloadable PDF document and Word document that I can click upon and more closely evaluate. After having done that, I can choose to add a numeric score for this particular student and can optionally offer textual or summary comments about that student's work. So this certainly can be useful in terms of highlighting the strengths of a student's assignment. It is also possible to use a grading rubric in this scenario, and there are actually a few tools within Sakai that allow for that we won't have the opportunity to today to explore. So I'm going to actually leave this area blank for now, assuming that in the future I will be leveraging the rubric feature. And after having done that, I will choose to save but not release to this particular student. So if we return to the list now, we can see what's changed. So most notably, now the student that we've graded does have a status of graded, and the score is being presented to us, but we don't see that the grade has yet been released to that student. There is, if I were to back that statement up a little bit, it's common practice and a preference of many instructors to release all grades to all students at roughly the same moment. If that is your preference, adding additional feedback to other students by, of course, clicking upon their name and choosing to add feedback within the space, just as I did previously, will also produce a grade here and then ultimately here for my other students that, though they've not resulted in a release notification being presented just yet, I can choose to release those grades using a more master option here that will release the entire row. In this case, just the singular row that we've chosen to evaluate manually. So that's the assignments tool. It's a useful tool for receiving submissions from your students, of course, from Word and PDF documents, but can also, in fact, be used for different sorts of media like video or image documents. If you are interested in overseeing assignments of those types, please do feel free to get in contact with the CPIs. We'd love to discuss the implementation of those sorts of assignments and the different measures for doing so. So now that we've evaluated the assignment for this particular student, we'll take a look at the gradebook to see that it actually will have occurred within the weekly reflection column that, if you recall previous to visiting the assignments tool, this column wasn't being presented to us because there was no data to show just yet. But now there is. And this is, again, a representation of a consolidation of the scores from the assignments tool, now in one spot. I would note the little lock icon that's being presented to us here. Now, what this indicates is that we're actually not able to make changes to this score here in the gradebook. We'll, in fact, need to visit the assignments tool in order to make a change that will ultimately be passed here into the gradebook tool when the change is made. This has been found to actually be quite helpful in terms of your version control and workflow, in particular when there are multiple marker graders or instructors working within a course and within an assignment. So lastly, we're going to take a look at using the lessons tool within Sakai. So this is something that we're just going to touch upon in today's workshop. Again, I would certainly refer you to the information at the bottom of this video or the details of this video for more information about more robustly using the lessons tool and creating online modules within Sakai. But it does bear a little bit of exploration today given the current context. So we'll enable a new version of the lessons tool, in fact, by clicking upon the site info, just as with other tools, and then clicking upon manage tools, and then choosing to enable the lessons tool. Okay, so we've got our blank canvas now ready for us to begin using. Again, the lessons tool is a tool that is quite handy for facilitating fully fledged online modules, but can also be simply used to make a more interactive version of your course syllabus or outline, and can be instead a stand-in for a PDF document or a Word document that you may have previously used. As well, this information can be imported and brought forth to future Sakai sites that you may use in future course deliveries, which is good to keep in mind. So we'll actually begin by adding a sub-page to our lessons tool today, allowing for the kind of primary page to serve as a table of contents. This allows for students to understand that when they've clicked upon lessons, they'll actually be given a range of lessons on a per-week basis. So we'll start by creating a page that will just address the week one content. In fact, I'll choose to demonstrate it or show it as a button. So if we jump back just one step, we'll now see that after we've clicked upon the lessons tool, we're shown a button for a week one page. And for good measure, let's add another. Oops. All right, so now we're being presented with a week one and week two. Naturally, many courses being a great many weeks more than two, it may be useful to create buttons or subpages to address each of those, but certainly to each instructor, a design needs to flow from the course's needs. So now we'll begin actually configuring the week one content. So we'll begin by actually adding a title fact, I'm unsure that welcome to is a useful feature here. So then we'll choose to make this a heading 2, just to indicate that this is in fact a title, and then add a little bit of information. And potentially more information to help contextualize what we're seeing. So now we've simply added a title to the week, but let's as well indicate the weekly learning incomes, outcomes. So we've now, which certainly ought to be fleshed out some, but for the benefits of today, this is what we're going with. So if we now choose to add a checklist for students, and a brief note about how that's helpful in an online environment in particular, providing some guidance to students in a way that may not certainly be possible in an online environment. In the way that it was in a brick and mortar classroom can be helpful. This includes opportunities for your students without your help or without you or a member of your teaching staff serving as an elbow buddy, for students to know if they're on the right track and as well if they've undertaken the tasks for the week or if they're missing anything. So now students can choose to self-report, as it were, what their progress has been. Even on the instructor side, in fact, you're able to choose to select boxes if you would like to test out the feature. I would note again that students do choose to self-report this, so the undertaking of these tasks doesn't automatically check boxes on behalf of a student. And while it is possible to check the breadth of your students to see who's undertaking these tasks and who's not, it's merely part of the picture, but perhaps not a full indication of the student's success within your course. So we'll also choose to add a video to our lessons tool here in much the same way that blogs from places across the web are able to stream sites or are able to stream YouTube videos. The lessons tool here in Sakai actually does have this same capability. So we'll begin by visiting a space within YouTube where we are aware that the video is already being presented, and certainly using your own methods for arriving at YouTube and locating the desired video is advised. All that's needed once you've located a video that you'd like to present is the URL or the address atop the page. So copying the URL and then returning to our Sakai lessons tool. And then afterwards choosing to embed content on page. And then pasting the URL within this space. Hmm. Okay, so I think I would like to add a little bit more contextualization around this video, though it is quite handy that it's embedded properly. Okay, so we're almost there. Now we'll want to ensure that this titling is actually in a space that's helpful to us. So clicking the reorder button will allow us to move that information. And so now we've undertaken the initial steps to creating our first online module. It is possible to integrate quite a bit more from your Sakai site into the lessons tool. You are more than welcome to contact a member of CPI to explore usage of this tool and all kinds of other ideas on how to deliver content online, asynchronously, synchronously, and so forth in the upcoming terms. Just returning to our slide. As well, you are quite welcome to contact the Center for Pedagogical Innovation at edtech@brocky.ca, that's edtech@brocky.ca, if you have any questions about the content that we've explored today. Otherwise, I wish everyone well, and I do thank you for watching, and look forward to perhaps the opportunity to communicating with you in the terms moving forward.